Hey, I hope you can hear me. This is the first time I'm doing this, so I have no idea what I'm doing. All right. Hi. There are actually people watching. Wow. That's pretty amazing. I feel very, you know that meme where Steve Buscemi is in a high school and he's like, "How you doing, fellow kids?" That's how I feel doing a live stream. Yeah. Hi, Ale. Hey, everyone. What are we gonna do here? All right. Let me tell you what I'm doing. Cool. You can hear me. That's great. Right. Why am I doing this? I hate social media. That's mostly why I'm doing this. Yeah, I mean, I love social media because I can talk to you guys and you give me amazing feedback, and I love everything about that. And that gives me a lot of energy and confidence to keep going. But I also hate most other things about it. And so I figured this is a much more, I feel much more comfortable just talking to you in person, and to be more in depth rather than, you know, whatever catchy thing I can come up with a single caption on an Instagram post and just tell you about things that I'm not able to do in 140 characters and all that. So yeah, I might do this, I don't know, once a month, maybe more, maybe less. We'll see. When I feel like it, not putting pressure on myself. And feel free to suggest other songs that you'd like me to do. And yeah, I'm gonna talk about Be Still, My Tongue here. But if there's anything else you wanna ask, just hit me up and I'm watching the chat so I can respond. Yeah, so this is my new-ish studio. I've been here since October, November last year, and I'm sharing it with a friend of mine and really happy to be here. It's like more than twice the size of the room I was in before, and makes me feel like I'm a real musician almost. Almost. I'm getting there. I'm getting there. Yeah. Shall we? Let's talk about Be Still. Be Still, My Tongue. It's one of the songs. Yeah, it's on Orbit, as you probably know if you're on here. And it's one of the last songs I wrote for that album. So, Orbit, most of it I wrote in 2017. And just to give you a little bit of context and background, I was working on Broadchurch, the last season of Broadchurch with Ólafur Arnalds, in 2016, 2017, and then we scored a film together, this documentary called Out of Thin Air, right after. And yeah, and that was kind of my working for Ole was kind of my day job for a few years, where I would go in and do one or two big projects with him, make money, live cheap, and save enough money that I could take a few months off to do my own music. And that's what happened here. So we did those things together, and then I went off and did Orbit, basically. And Be Still, My Tongue, I wrote. I don't remember when or where I wrote all of the songs, but I do remember very well what happened with Be Still, because it's this amazing, amazing thing when you have a vacation. So, my wife is from Toronto, or her family lives in Toronto, and we went there in July, something like that, June, July in 2017. And for a few weeks, I came back home to Iceland, sat down at my home piano and like literally the first thing I came up with was this little thing here. Like, as often happens with my music, I don't really know where to go from there. So that's basically the entire song. These six chords with like two rounds of these three chords. And yeah, it's this amazing thing when when you're sort of plowing through something, you're working on something for such a long time and you feel stuck, and then you just take a little break, take a fucking break. Have a vacation, come back, and I'm like, hey, I'm creating something that I kind of like. I can tell you right away, and that wasn't conscious, but I know that subconsciously this is. I'd been listening to the Revenant soundtrack, so just to give you, and the main theme from the Revenant, just to show you, like it's quite. I don't know why I'm showing you this. This doesn't look good for me, but. Listen to this. So it's these simple chords, and it just sort of ends on a crescendo and then stops, and there's a huge space in the middle, in between, and it is, that's exactly what I was, I think, subconsciously imitating when I wrote this. And my idea was always for this to be, even when I'm sitting at the piano first, my idea is always that this is going to be a string section, like a big string section. And with here, with just space, reverb forever, which reminds me of a really good YouTube comment I saw on the song once where it was like, this song is so annoying, it just keeps stopping. And then just when I think it's starting again, it keeps stopping again. Like, yeah. Sorry. I love space. Yeah. And that's the harmony. If you wanna, let's do it. Let's go harmony. I'm a huge harmony nerd. I love harmonics, and like, I think about harmonics very consciously when I write. I grew up in a very classical environment, and that comes very natural to me. But yeah, so what I'm doing here is, this is F sharp minor, but in, I don't know these terms in English. So it's basically this chord here, but moved one step up, so you have the third in the bass. And then I just move that same chord down a step. So here's the tonic in the bass. And then I go to this chord. And what I like about it is that when you hear just these three chords, you feel that the tonic is here. When I play just like this sounds like the tonic to me. But what happens then is that I go, and this here doesn't sound like the tonic anymore, because the tonic, that isn't the tonic. So after this is the tonic. And that can also work as the tonic over the rest, over the opening chords. So you can hear like this. This is the tonic. Inversion. Thank you, Ale. And yes, it's C sharp minor is the key, but it starts with an F sharp minor. And so it's a tiny bit of like, it's a little bit of an illusion that you think that it's gonna be an F sharp minor. When I start here, You think this is the tonic, but it's actually the fourth place. Fourth, again, don't know these terms in English, but yeah, so it's the fourth in C sharp. And I think I'm probably boring the shit out of you now by harmony, but that's basically it. This is the whole song, these chords. Yeah. And then very quickly on, I knew I wanted to use the space in between to sing over it. And it's interesting because I didn't really end up singing in the space. I kind of sang on top of the chords, and I liked it better that way, just to leave the space completely empty, so you hear nothing but the space in between. But I ended up singing over it, and I was sort of bereft of ideas, and I'm writing melodies isn't what comes supernaturally to me. Harmonics are my thing. That's I start with chords always. So I went over to our fridge in the kitchen, and in our house we have this on our fridge we have this magnetic poetry set. It's basically where you have like magnets on the fridge, and each magnet has a word, and you can just sort of put random words in order to make a poem on your fridge, or make, doesn't have to be a poem, can be whatever. It's a great party game. After every party, it usually our fridge would say something like suck, or you get the drift. And my wife had written a poem on the fridge, and just to give you the context, that this was her first winter in Iceland, and so 2016, 2017, we had lived, so I met her in Spain. She's from Serbia, then grew up in Canada, but we met in Spain and we lived in Spain. And then we lived in Mexico, so two very sunny, warm places. And then we moved to Iceland 5 years ago. And her first winter, it was difficult for me as well coming back. I didn't really, because before I moved away from Iceland, I was just used to it. But then experiencing winter again in Iceland was hard. But not as hard as it was for her. Even though she's from Toronto, she's Canadian, it's not the same. It's not the same. It gets colder in Canada for sure, but the weather is just absolutely horrible here most of the time. And of course, the darkness. And so she wrote this very she wrote this poem, and I'm gonna put it up for you here. Hold on, give me a sec. So, here you go. So this is the actual poem that was in the fridge. Winter is wet and stops all days from lighting. Spring sleeps like honey in a hive. Be still, my tongue. Soon you will eat hot, fast, and sweet. And that's it. And now that I'm reading it, what she's talking about is, winter is wet. Winter in Reykjavik is wet and miserable because it doesn't really snow as much here as in the countryside, and it just rains a lot, or it's like sort of in between. It's the sleet, and it's just like constantly, and it's so dark, stops all days from lighting. And so she's talking about, she's waiting for spring. She's like hibernating, waiting for spring. She's hungry. She's a hungry little bear, hibernating, waiting for spring to come. Then she can eat. So be still, my tongue, as in like you will get to eat something soon. You hungry, depressed bear. And there was just something about this line, be still, my tongue, that I thought was very catchy. It inspired me. It had a certain rhythm to it. And I don't know why exactly, but I just took that line and then And my everything, the whole lyric in my song is I think a change stops all, I think it stops, I think I sing stops my days from lighting. It just sounded better when I sang it. So this here is what was my version? And yeah, the line winter is wet kind of sounds strange in this context now that I'm looking at it. Yeah, but that was the inspiration, and I just sat down at the piano and immediately, like, the melody that came with just seeing this line, "Be still my tongue," was just this one. "Be still my tongue." And the melody works really well, I think, with this harmonic illusion that I was talking about earlier, because you it kind of sounds like I'm just floating around the tonic, which is but then when you go into here, "Be still you realize that I wasn't floating around the tonic. I'm starting on the third, going up to the fourth, and then to the fifth, and that's where it sort of really hits. That's where it really shines, the melody. So I think together this very, very simple melody works well with this sort of simple harmonic illusion that, yeah. Yeah, so that's kind of how I originally wrote it, just at the piano, and then, and then it's a question of going in here. And that's how I usually do things. I might sit at the piano first. Not always, but it's very often the case. I'm sitting at the piano, I come up with an idea, I have an idea, and I bring it in here into Pro Tools as quickly as possible so I can work with it, record a demo, hear it myself, imagine what could come next. And yeah, and and this is the actual mix session from the track. And I mean, if you've heard the track, like, it's a long track, it's a big track, it sounds huge. It's the biggest track on Orbit, it's the longest track on Orbit, it has the most elements, but at the same time, it's very, very simple. So let's dig in. Let's start with the strings because that's what opens the song. So I'm gonna give you an idea of how I worked it. So this is these are just the sample strings. And someone asked on Instagram what samples I used in the songs. And I don't use any samples in the songs. They're all real instruments. I thought until I looked into the session and I remembered there is actually a double bass here that I'll show you later. That is, I just added sort of in the climax of the song. I just added a sample double bass. I didn't record any double basses. They weren't part of the string orchestra. But anyway, so this is how it sounded just with the samples. And it doesn't sound good. Here you go. Yeah, so Jessica, you're mentioning the piano that I was playing just now. Yeah, I'm playing a MIDI piano. I'm sitting at the computer. My real piano is over there behind me. But this piano sample that I'm using and I used for this song is the Ólafur Arnalds Spitfire piano. This one. And one very simple reason I'm using it is that obviously I was working with him at the time. And so for everything I worked on for his music, we obviously used that because this is his actual grand piano. And that's also the piano I was going to record. So it made perfect sense to use that piano sample. Sorry, going back to the strings. So yeah, the string samples, they don't sound great, but I don't need them to sound great because I know they're not going to be the finished version. It's enough so that I can hear the potential it has when it will be performed by live human players. And that's all that matters to me. Just so you can hear it with the string sound with the melody that comes in later. And again, this is all just samples, no real players. Then we can listen to the same spot but with the actual strings, just so you can hear the difference. Yeah, I think I have everything there. There you go. So, yeah. Real players, alive, human emotion, makes all the difference in the world. And I get a lot of questions through my social media from composers, from producers who want to know like what's the sample I should use for my thing? And I really don't know what to tell them because I don't really use samples for my finished tracks. Whatever is easy to work with and is good enough for you to hear the potential with for when you use live instruments. I know I'm realistic. I know we can't always afford to do that. Like all of my savings went into recording these strings. But yeah. Right. So that so yeah, so blur, blur, blur. My head is fried. So this is the. Let's keep talking about the strings while we're at it. So this is the Budapest Art Orchestra in Budapest. I was in my own studio here in Reykjavik, in my tiny, tiny, tiny little cupboard studio in Reykjavik, and I'm listening in on the recording session. So I just send them the Pro Tools session, and I send them the scores. We can maybe look them later as well, and then I am communicating with them in real time as I listen to. So I listen to the takes and I say, oh, let's fix this thing in bar 17, let's make a bigger crescendo. And yeah, you're asking a lot about the strings, right? Yeah, so recorded in Budapest, the setup was 22 players, I think. I think it was, no, it was 22. Yeah, I think it was 8, 6. Was it 8, 6, 5, 5, 8, 6, 4, or was it just 20 players? Something like that. It was a small. You know, it wasn't like a chamber orchestra, but it was around 20. I think it was like 20, 22 players. So eight, I think it was, I'm pretty sure it was eight first violins, six second violins, then maybe six violas and four cellos. Something like that. Or possibly four violas and four cellos. Yeah, that sounds more plausible. 8, 6, 4, 4. Yeah, that makes sense. 22. I think I got it. Let's wrap it up. Eight first violins, six second violins, four violas, and four cellos. And then I added the extra double bass sample here. And I recorded the entire album, Orbit, in this one session in 2.5 hours. It was exhilarating. I'm in my studio because, I'm just trying to save time and money. It's expensive to record an orchestra. And so I recorded, I think there are eight tracks on Orbit, and there's only one. Right, there are two tracks that don't have a string orchestra in it. And I recorded strings for Imperial as well, which I released later. So I recorded seven tracks in 2.5 hours. Yeah. So it was like, yeah, I was super organized. I was ready to go. I was super nervous. And I was like, okay, three takes. That's it. Let's go to the next one. And I can show you some places where there are mistakes. And I tried to hide it in the mix. And I think it worked out okay. But yeah, so this, I think I recorded this string orchestra section in like 20 minutes, basically, for this song. And what I'm doing with the string, what you're seeing here is, so this here is, these are, I think I threw out all the close mics because I'm not really using any individual lines. I don't have any solo instruments. I mean, I do have solo instruments, but I recorded them here in the studio myself. And so I'm not, yeah, so I didn't use any of the close mics from Budapest. So what you see here, you have the left. This is the Decca tree. And that's just kind of, for those of you who don't know, that's just a mic setup sort of hanging over the orchestra. So you have three mics, so one to the right and one to the left and one dead center. And those are three mics, and I'm routing them to a separate aux track that I mix separately. And then there were two, a stereo pair, like of even wider, sort of further in the back mics. That's this channel here. And yeah, and then I put that plus the Decca tree into together onto this sort of, yeah, onto this aux track where I mix everything together as well. And so here, the Decca tree, I use the FabFilter Pro Q. I'm on to Pro Q 3 now. That wasn't out, or maybe it was out. I didn't have it at the time. And the UID Pultec EQ, another EQing. And same as here, you just have general EQing. And it's not super fancy what I'm doing. I'm mostly, you'll see this a lot in my music and probably most of modern classical music, where the strings are taken down quite a lot around the 2K area. And that's sort of where the sort of, I don't know how to put it, like when you hear a violin, it has a certain nasal quality, like nyeh type of sound. And that is around the 2K mark. And so when you take that down, you usually get like, I mean, it's not for everything, of course, but for this type of sound, it usually makes everything sound a little bit smoother, warmer, less nasal, less aggressive, less abrupt. Yeah. And then, yeah, so then the main aux for the strings I'm sending to a Lexicon reverb, which is up here, the UAD Lexicon 224. And then I was lucky enough to have access to all kinds of cool gear in Olav's studio. So that's, let's assemble this thing here. This thing here is the strings run through an actual EMT 246 plate, that he has, and I remember, I think he had just gotten it back from being, it was being repaired, and he had just gotten it back, and then the two of us sort of sat for an hour or two just figuring out what the nicest reverb tail for this phrase was, the nicest setting on the plate. And then here, I think we ran it through the Roland Space Echoes. And yeah, which is this sort of gives it even more space. And that's what I wanted. I wanted to fill up the space with this floaty, floaty reverb. So if I, you know, if I play this for you without the reverb, and if I just played dry, it sounds like this. See? Sounds nice because the hall in Budapest is nice, but when they let go, it's just completely dead, and this music doesn't work. So, and my friends, my Berkeley friends in particular, are gonna make fun of me because I use a lot of reverb, and I used a lot of reverb, and they made constant fun of me for that, and so they're gonna laugh at me. But yeah, this doesn't work without the reverb, and just in comparison, here's the thing with the reverb again. So night and day. We want more nose. Cool. Love it. Thanks, Obi. Yeah. All right. And yeah, and then of course, so for this track, because I wanted it to sound big, I didn't want to have to split up the orchestra too much. So when the very romantic melody comes in, this one here, I recorded that separately so I could use again the full orchestra to record, or at least the full violin section to play this and this. Yeah, and I can show you if any of you read music. So these are the two sets of scores for this track, for the string orchestra. So you have this here is the main strings, the chords that you're hearing. So you have the there are three notes basically in each chord, and the top note is doubled in the violins. So you see they're playing the same notes until the last chord, where it splits. So you have, and then they go on this dissonant minor second, and that kind of repeats in the second round. And they have this note, and then go split here. And yeah, so that's what are these are the main strings. What else to tell you there? You can see sort of my dynamic. So it's starting from piano crescendo to a mezzo piano, so very soft, but then crescendo on the last chord and letting go on the crescendo. So we get this reverb tail, nice and big, lasting, because it's like six whole beats until it starts over again. And to maximize that, you see these symbols here, this V-like symbol, and this thing here. If you're a string player, you obviously know, but so this means that this should be played on an upbeat. So they're playing these two bars here continuously on an upbeat. So like that, la, ba-da-ra-ra-ra. And that's because you get sort of, it's easier to do a crescendo on an upbeat. It's more natural to do a crescendo on an upbeat, and then it's more natural for, if you want to make an emphasis, to do a down Down, upbeat, not an upbeat. Up bow is what I'm trying to say. Sorry. And then for an embassy, for more emphasis, you want to have a down bow. So that's what I'm doing here. I have the up bow during the crescendo, and then the emphasis is on this third chord. Yeah, and I mean that's kind of the same all throughout. I mean it's the same chords, pretty much. Like I vary it tiny little bit, but this is the same all throughout, pretty much. And this thing here are the overdubs. This is the main melody. I'm just doing them in octave, so it's two lines, and it's kind of like a little canon. So you can see the if I play it just on the piano, you hear. So this is the. I'm on bar 42 now, 43, and then this continues down, and this line, it doesn't go up to the main melody again. It finishes like this because then I have violins two, again also split in octaves. I don't know, I'm pointing at my screen as if you can see. I'm pointing with my hands. They are split in octaves like here. And same as here. And so they're splitting up, they're taking turns doing this la da da da. They're taking turns doing that. So together it sounds like something like this. And here the second violinist take over the melody. Switch again. And now the first violins have the melody again, and so on. And that's pretty much all there is. Yeah, dynamics, not much happen. I mean, it's very basic. There's this slight portamento, it's like glissando, where you instead of doing ba da, it goes la, just like not as long as I just sang it now, but. Just like a little bit, so it slides down a little bit more than having it just. So let's have a listen. Yes, I did do that in Sibelius. I do work in Sibelius. I, like everyone else, have a love-hate relationship with Sibelius that is 90% hate. But it's the one I know, so I'm still using it. So there you go. Yeah. All right. That is pretty much it with the strings, except there is the solo viola. And this is, like I said, I recorded it myself in the studio. And this is the amazing Carl James Pesca, or Kalli, as he's known around here. So this is, yeah, this is the solo viola. So on, same with that, just slight EQ, probably taking down the 2K mark, as you can see here, and the rest is just picking out the sort of nasty sounding overtones, usually something in the space wherever you're recording. Some overtones will be enhanced for whatever reasons inside the space, so they will sort of crank ups, and so this is sort of just taming those. And yeah, the idea with this viola line is, so I can play you, so let's listen to it with the vocals, even though I'm not a fan of actually playing my own vocals solo. But so you'll notice that the viola line starts on the exact same note as the vocals, so that the vocals end on. So here's what the vocals, how the vocals end.
From lighting.
So you can hear that the viola starts on the same on the same note with the vocals. And my original idea was that I was gonna actually sing this line and somehow make it like go from lighting. And then I tried it, and yeah, it just didn't make any sense. First of all, to perform it, I was never gonna do that in one take, and it just I couldn't get it to work, even though the idea was kind of nice. I think my idea was to sort of start with the vocals, then maybe morph it into strings. But yeah, it turned out to be a bit much for me to handle, yeah, to produce it. So I ended up just doing this, and I think it works really nice. The viola, I think I love the viola. It has such a thick, warm sound, and particularly in this register, and it's a very similar register to where my voice sounds the best, and so I love combining the two. And so it's sort of like a natural follow-up from my own vocals. Yeah, shall we do the vocals? Yeah, let's do the vocals. Let's do the vocals. So I'm gonna do the horrifying thing, and I'm gonna play you the original take without anything. So this is what it sounds like. It's probably tuned, thank God. But yeah, so this is without anything. Yeah, and in my music, in this song, it doesn't. There's, of course, music where you want to have the voice up close and dry and in your face, but you know, this is a huge sounding song, so it makes a lot of sense to drown it in reverb. There you go. And so this is. You can sort of see what we've done here. I think this thing here is bounced from this thing, so it has all of these effects, so it's. A bit of EQing, de-essing, which I don't have anymore because I never really sing anymore. And but I de-ess manually. De-essing, if you don't know, it's where you're taming the S sounds. So because when you record it, it sounds very s. You hear it super loud. S's, F's, even K's, P's, these hard consonants. And this is a plugin that helps you tame those things. And yeah, and I was sending it to all kinds of things, but I think I bounced it dry to this track, and where, yeah, there's a little compression on it and more EQing. This is mostly, I mixed most of this myself, just so you know, but then I spent like 2 days mixing the entire album Orbit with Ate 800, who was amazing, and particularly with vocals, because I had never done vocals before in my life. I'd never mixed vocals, I'd never produced vocals. I was recording my own voice for the first time, sorry, and I had no idea what I'm doing, so I was really grateful to have his help. And yeah, so with everything, it sounds like this.
Still my tongue.
basically we're sending it to this reverb here, which is just a good old Pro Tools D-verb. And here, yeah, we have some EQing on the reverb just to, yeah, we're amping up the highs basically and the high mids. And that's kind of because my voice is very airy, so we do that a lot with my voice. We're sort of and we see that as a, I see that as a good thing. It's just a characteristic of my voice. And thanks, OB. Not sure I love you too, but bye. Yeah, so what was I saying? Yeah, so we're sort of accentuating the airiness of my voice and we're giving it even more sort of crunchiness than it. I think we're doing it here as well. Yeah, so you hear there's, we're upping the highs again here, and this is a saturation that's again that kind of takes that airiness of my voice and makes it kind of crunchy sounding, and it gives it a really nice, yeah, warmth to it. Here, and what you see here, we're automating a, I'm pretty sure that's Atte who did this, it's automating a reverb tail just at the end of the last phrase, so you hear from lighting. Yeah, sorry, I had it wrong before. The first reverb, the main reverb, is this one here. It's the EMT 140, that's right. And then the reverb tail that we're doing here for this is the D verb. And so, yeah, and you can see what we're doing. This is the send to that reverb. So we're not actually automating the volume of anything. We're automating the send to the reverb here. And yeah, and then when the voice comes back later in the chorus, it's similar, except it's treated even more. It has the Sound Toys crystallizer on it as well. And that sounds like this. Yeah, and this is to make it stand out a bit more. It gives it a more sort of ethereal quality, but by this time there are so many elements in the song and it's so easy to drown out that we wanted just to make it stand out a little bit more, even though it's pretty much impossible just with everything. It's let me make sure that all the samples are muted. Yeah, here we go. So my voice is basically drowning there, but it has this nice little extra fluttering of the crystallizer to help it out. I think I'm gonna move to the pianos now. And this was a huge mess, as you can see. So I started out by writing doing here. And I did this just with I wrote this here, I think. And I started out writing the main line, which goes here. That one, and then I added all the other ones. And the idea behind all these pianos, so with, you know, when they're all together, these are the sample ones. I can tell you my inspiration for this, and I've done this in so many songs. I'm layering multiple piano takes, and my inspiration for this is not The Revenant, it is Gustavo Santaolalla. And I went to the movies when I was 16 and I saw a film called Babel, and It has this track in it. I'd never heard it before. It has a lot of Ryuichi in it as well, but it has this track. This effect so much. It's ronroco, that's the instrument mainly, I think, and maybe just guitars as well. Ronroco is like a tenor version of the charango, which is these are Andean instruments, South American instruments. He's from Argentina, and he's layering them together. And I am a guitarist originally myself, so when I heard this, I started doing this. But then when I started writing more on the writing more on the piano, I thought to myself, why not do this on the piano? Why not try to sort of layer these sort of fast-paced but very simple minimalist piano lines together? And so that's what I'm doing here. But the problem is that later on I'm gonna have a beat come in, and so this needed to be perfectly in rhythm. And I mean perfectly, because if it isn't, you're gonna hear it. You're gonna hear the difference between the beat, which is completely on the grid. And if you hear the piano isn't like, if it's not in time, you're gonna notice just because of the nature of the very sort of rigid nature of the beat. And I'm not a good piano player. I'm not capable of playing these things so rhythmically like the samples. And I can tell you, I tried, and let's take a look at what I tried to do. And that's this here. So I recorded it on Olaver's grand piano, and you can hear it here. And this is not the final version. This is when I tried to play it myself. And it doesn't sound too bad now. It sounds very in rhythm because, and look at this. I completely forgot about this until I opened the session again. I cannot believe I did that. See where the clips cut, like here, here, 1,000 times here. Every one of these cuts, every single one of these cuts, is me moving often single notes. Or a cluster of notes, moving them onto the grid, tiny little bit. I'm quantizing it manually. I'm quantizing the audio manually, and I did this, and I did this. And like, look at this. This is insane. I must have spent like a day. Look at this. This is every single note here. I cut it, and I'm moving it to the grid. So it works like that. Okay, here actually I can see I've used the sort of Pro Tools help thing to do that, but that probably sounds terrible. Let's see what this sounds like with the beat. Actually, I'm curious. Yeah, I mean this is on the grid now because I've spent the time, but then here I have another problem is, and that comes down to one of your questions, how do you manage to have so many piano layers and not have them be messy in the mix? This is really messy in the mix. It's very muddy, it takes up a lot of space. And after all this work, I decided to, and this was me being stubborn, and I'm gonna be completely honest with you here, and when I wrote Orbit, I've been working for Olavid for a while, and I was so super aware that I didn't want to be a B version of Ólafur Arnalds. I didn't want to sound like a B version of Ólafur Arnalds. And so I was trying, even though I was recording most of this in his studio, because that was a studio I had access to. I was very trying very hard. I was so overly aware of it that it drove me crazy. I am, yeah, that was the headspace I was in at the time. And and I'm telling you that because I knew what I wanted to do the whole time, and that was to use his self-playing pianos. He has a pair of self-playing pianos that are able to receive MIDI and play it perfectly. And of course, that's what I ended up doing eventually. And let's take a look at them. So here are the final, with one actually exception, the first line. That's me playing it on the grand piano. And it's slightly lower in register. It's more of a solo line to begin with. So I wanted it to sound a bit more human and less robotic than the other pianos. And so I ended up keeping that. But you can still see on every single cut here that I'm still, you know, I still had to move it to place it with the piano robots. And so if you haven't seen this from Ólafur, he has videos about these pianos. They're pretty amazing. So basically the MIDI here from the sampled ones, which sounded like this, I'm just sending this MIDI out to, I route them through Pro Tools to the receiver on the piano, and they actually play it perfectly. You have to mess with the velocities in the MIDI a little bit because it's kind of random how the dynamics on them, like one note, certain notes will be stronger than another. So I had to spend a lot of time doing that, but it was worth it because, and this piano is, it's a lot smaller sounding than a grand piano. These pianos are uprights. They're Yamaha. It's the Yamaha disc clavier. And yeah, so with all together, this is what they sound like. Yeah, compared to, like, this is very light. You can hear the texture of the hammer striking because there's a felt on the string, so you can hear the so it adds almost like a percussive element, but it's all very light compared to this. Which is very heavy, muddy, takes up so much space and width because there are so many other elements and we need to make space for each and every one of them. It just didn't work in the mix. So this is what I ended up doing with the piano. I ended up using them, and microphones, the grand piano, I used the AKG C12, and I'm pretty sure the player pianos have, so they're actually in mono, so they're basically stereo. So the right piano has one mic, and the left piano has another mic, and you can actually hear. Yeah, someone was asking for to hear them individually, and that's what you can hear. You're gonna hear it mono now. So, and I pan them. You pan them just hard. The right piano, I'm panning it hard right, and left piano, I'm panning it hard left. So, this is the right piano. That's one line. Here's another one. Actually, let's build it up. Let's do that. Let's build it up from the first one. So this is the one I play myself, and that's the first one to come in. And then I add this one here, the one that's tinkling high up. Yeah, no worries. This is gonna be up on YouTube forever, I think, unless I do something really embarrassing from now on. So here, the left piano is coming in. And yeah, also the right piano has this one just short line. So when I play this live, I actually I cheat a little bit. So I play the main one with my left hand, and then I play one of them. I picked the strongest one. So I'm playing. Jesus, that was loud. Sorry. On playback, but it sounds cool when it comes together. Then in the end, I think I'm adding more. Yeah, just this one is just voicing. It's the same as the one above it, but just in thirds. And then I added just some melody here. Yeah. Let's look at, and I know a lot of you asked about this yesterday, the beats. So the beats, I didn't make them. That was my friend Drew, who was making some bad jokes in the chat earlier I saw. I don't know if he's still here. If you are, hey Drew. Yeah. So Drew, let's see if I can find the original one that he... is that? No, wait, hold on. I don't know. Let's see. Yeah. Yeah, so this is basically how I first got it from Drew. So Drew worked on, sorry, they were great jokes, Drew. Drew did beats on this track. He did Homeless, not the opening growly thing that Homeless starts with, that's me, but the sort of what the more fast paced thing that comes later. And what else did you do, Drew? The Unfortunate Fortune and Imperial. And so, and it's slightly different how we worked it. So both Imperial and Homeless, they were tracks where I gave them to Drew and said, hey, can you add beats to this thing? And so he designed the beats for those particular tracks. Whereas this track, Be Still and The Unfortunate Fortune, was me writing around just random beats that Drew had given me. So Drew works mo mainly or worked mainly in Ableton, and Drew, you write in if I'm wrong. And yeah, so he sent me like a folder with a bunch of different stuff, and I took it, and I was really inspired by them. And again, like this was my first album. This is the first time I was releasing some of my music. And again, I was so aware I didn't wanna be yet another wannabe Oliver, wannabe Niels. And so I wanted to be different. That's partially why I sing a lot on the album, and that's partially why there are a lot of these sort of glitchy sounding beats on the album, because I thought it was something different. And these are decisions made from complete insecurity, I think, looking back. I think I'm more confident now and feel like maybe, and this is not to take anything away, not to take anything away from Drew. This is amazing stuff, and I love it, and I love that I did this. But I'm not sure. I probably wouldn't go this far to make something this different, because even though I like it and it sounds cool, it sounds great, I think looking back, the point, I don't think I was necessarily making it. I wasn't necessarily putting on beats on all the tracks, and these particular beats, because I thought they were what the songs needed. Again, not taking anything away from them, but I think at least partially the decision to go with them came just from the desire to be different. And yeah, which is perfectly fine too. But that's how it was. But let's dig in. So yeah, so you heard how they sounded. This is what it sounded originally, and then I asked Drew to send me the stems so I could actually sort of go in there, and I adjusted them to the song a little bit more. So it's pretty simple what I'm doing. You have the snares here onto a separate channel, and I had a reverb, and these are the sends. So if I just have solo the snares, hold on. Here we go. Just solo the snares. Here we go. You can hear this one's pretty dead, but here just made a tail like that, and that's just to give it a bit more variety. And you can hear it if I play the entire perk. So these snares were dead, but now, so that one is living. Little things like that. And you know, I cut it. I started out with a filter on it, just a basic, the UAD Moog filter. Sorry, that's the delay. Here's the filter. I'm sending it to a filter. Yeah, here's a saturation as well. And so you can see I start with the filter on. Where did it go? And then I bring it up. You can hear the moment it comes up. It opens up a little bit. It's not huge, but it's just a little bit different. You can see, and then when you have the sort of final repetition of the melody here, I bring the filter up even more, just to open up slightly more, barely noticeable. Yeah. And that's pretty much all I did to it. Yeah, I mean, there are some EQs. This is the reverb, so there's filter on the reverb as well. Yeah. I don't know what else to tell you guys. Do you guys have any particular questions? Anything you would particularly like to know about the track before we finish this thing? Let me know. How long it took me to make Be Still? I mean, not that, I don't know. I mean, it didn't take me long. It's a very simple song to write because it's just these sort of six chords over and over and over and over again, and with the repeated melody, which is also really simple. Production-wise, it took me longer. You can obviously see that I must have spent like a couple of days doing this, even though I ended up this is the piano that I recorded myself. But yeah, that must have taken a while. But yeah, like I said, string orchestra, I recorded in 20 minutes. You know, but there are always things writing up the scores. I can't tell you in specific time how much time it took me to write this particular song or make it, but it was a fairly short turnaround. I think I wrote it in July, August, and I recorded the strings for Orbit all in August. So like in the same month I had already recorded strings for this, and then I finished mixing the album in early 2018. So yeah. Was I scared of not doing enough at some point? I'm always scared of not doing enough. I'm constantly scared of everything. No, if anything, I think I was scared of going too big with this song. It's a little, I mean, I'm just gonna like the song is pretty cheesy. It's the right kind of cheese in my opinion. That's why I make it, that's why I like it. But it's pretty cheesy, and if anything, I was afraid, you know, when you have everything together, like let's go to the and like what's even happening here? There are so many things, there's so many elements here. I was afraid that I was going too big, especially, oh yeah, because the melody here with these like overly lush violins just everywhere. I was maybe afraid that I was gonna, yeah, that it was too much, too big, too cheesy. Yeah, that was my fear more than anything else, I think. So, yeah. Yeah, I totally agree. That's why it works, because it has a very, very, very long build-up. Oh, yeah, one, I was gonna tell you with the beats, there's one thing that cracks me up. When we after we released Orbit, Be Still wasn't a single because it's just so long. I think that was the reasoning behind it, and yeah, Homeless and Still Life were the main singles. And but yeah, when we released Orbit, I think we collaborated with one of these YouTube channels where they post like that, one of these huge channels that have like a billion subscribers, and they just they get music for free in exchange for the promotion that it gives you. And you know, and I was just starting out, so we did that, and it was one of these channels that it just does like very simple sort of anime artwork and pairs it together with the music, and then like it's a wonderful community of subscribers to those channels that like comment stories and write stories in the comments based on what the song and the artwork inspired them to feel like. And but when I was starting out, like I read all of the comments and because you know I wanted to get that feedback, get well, what are people saying about me, and I read all of them, and 90% of them were, like I said, people writing stories, writing poetry even, which was bizarre but also really cool. And then the rest was mostly really positive, really lovely, really confidence boosting. Made my day so often going through that. But every now and then, if you scroll through it, you can, if you just search for Be Still My Tongue on YouTube, this is what it's is going to come up. Yeah, HD sound, exactly. And very grateful because I think, you know, that sort of spiked, having it on there spiked the interest in this sound, in this song to begin with. And it started streaming well as soon as it got onto that channel. So I'm super, super grateful. But in these comments, like, I bet you there are like 20, like 10 to 20 different comments where it's like the time code of the exact moment when the beat drops. And it's like, oh, 4 minutes, 2 seconds is where the song is ruined. It's like, oh God. And a few similar comments about the vocals as well. And I find it very funny. And it's like this, not to get on a soapbox or anything, but it's like, it's this thing where, you know, we get so much content all of the time, always. Like we sit in front of our TV, we're holding our phones, we're scrolling on social media while watching TV, and our iPad is sitting over there. And I think we're constantly craving serenity, calm, peace. And that's why modern classical music now, this genre that I've been sort of pigeonholed into. Yeah, thanks for ruining the song, Drew. Yeah, this genre is doing so well. It's so popular because it has this very mellow, often feel. It's not offensive, it's not abrasive, it's not aggressive. It's very comforting, it's comfortable, and it doesn't take you out of the comfort zone. And that's why when you go to Spotify and you go into these huge playlists like Peaceful Piano or like Study or whatever, you know, you have these endless sort of piano songs, and some of them are really amazing, some of them are like by artists that I know and amazing artists, but a lot of it is just like super generic stuff designed to just sort of sedate you. And so when you have all of a sudden like a super glitchy beat drop after 4 minutes in this very romantic modern classical song, I understand that people are just like, you know, they're floating in their with their anime artwork, and then it's just like boom, kush. What's that? Why do I feel aware again? Why am I Yeah. And the same thing with vocals. And I was advised not to sing on my music because, you know, it's not gonna stream as well, and it's not gonna, anyway. But I was really stubborn, and I sang a lot, and I put a lot of beats, and people are right, it doesn't stream as well as other stuff I released, which has no vocals and no beats. So there we have it. Anyway, that was my soapbox. Not to be bitter or anything, I'm so grateful for every single person listening for whatever reason they're listening, and I'm so grateful that there are people watching me right now. Jesus Christ, that's surreal. Yeah, more questions. Did I think about every part of the song before the recording sessions, or did you choose some changes in the process in terms of structure of voices? I mean, I think it's pretty, I think recording comes sort of close to the very end. And that's why I start very early in here in Pro Tools in the writing process. So I know exactly, sort of, more or less, what the song is going to sound like in its finished version. So that, you know, I don't want to go in, I don't want to spend, you know, $2,000 on a recording session and then realize afterwards, like, whoops, I want to change this now. So no, I try at least to have everything pretty much set in stone before going into record, before I go into record. But, you know, of course, there are always things. I definitely have changed some things after recording in some stuff that I've worked on. I don't think I did so here. I think this was pretty. I'm looking at the. I was looking at. I've been looking at the MIDI here, and it's all following the. You can see exactly like this is the strings, and this these are the strings here. It's all following the song. It's on the grid. I don't think I changed much of anything. Oh yeah, I added this. I was gonna show you. I added this double bass sample, which sounds like this. And that's the only sample thing in the entire production. And it's doubled by these synths. Oh yeah, I didn't even talk about the synths. I'm gonna do it very quickly. I'm gonna, it's been long enough. So I have these just, I think it's just the Juno 60, or it might just be the soft synth. I don't even remember. And the synths, the sub synth and the double bass are just playing the same thing, and it's just adding more bass to the, you know, to these chords here. So that's kind of, I think this bass I added after the fact. Yeah. Oh, and just before I forget, the last thing I haven't talked about is these synths here. And I can get into this sound maybe in some other songs where they're more apparent, but I did this a lot on Orbit. I where I doubled strings. You can hear it very well in Still Life, in Imperial, where I double strings with this very sort of mellow sounding synth. Have another synth line here. See, and this these chord synths here that are doubling the main strings, I'm holding off on them. They don't appear until after the beat comes in and you hear the sort of the song comes back after the interlude. Yeah, I think this has been plenty. This has been way longer than I meant it to be. I'm sorry if you got bored, but I hope this was interesting to s at least some of you, and just to give you a little insight into my process. And let's do this again sometime with other tracks. Message me wherever, tell me what songs you would like me to do, and I'll try to do them. And yeah, and then maybe next time we can talk a little bit more about what's coming up, what I've been working on recently, what I got coming out fairly soon, things like that. So yeah, I'm gonna say bye. Thank you so much for tuning in. Again, so grateful for all of you. See you soon. What was that? That was terrible. That's the worst. That was like Arrested Development, Lucille, just like full on, just like.